Ben DeCastro, carpooling with Ben. Thanks for tuning in. Today I've got a legendary saxophone player, and I learned how to spell saxophone, by the way. I don't know if you've noticed.
I like it.
I try. Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Bob Bowlby. Bob,
hello, everybody.
Thanks, Sue. So for coming in today.
And, it's a pleasure.
Going for a ride. Beautiful day out. I mean,
it's unusual.
It's hard to believe.
December 27th.
I'll take it. Of course, by the time this airs or by the time people watch this, we could have like 6 feet of snow and a blizzard of 78 all over again. But you have played all over the world.
Yeah.
You have played for many years with some of the most amazingly accomplished musicians out there. I mean, your resume goes for miles and miles, and you're a New England guy. You're a Boston kind of guy.
Yeah.
You've been, when did you start playing saxophone, and how many instruments do you play?
Well, I'll go back to the beginning. My father was a pianist.
Okay.
He didn't play full-time professionally, but he was an accomplished player that used to play on the weekends and do, you know, parties and what they call GB work or club date work, casual, you know, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, you'd play two weddings or parties or whatever, you know, and there used to be a lot of that for live music back in the day.
Yeah.
And that was an acoustic quartet or quintet. Nobody had music. You had to know all the tunes.
Mm-hmm.
And my father knew, I don't know how many standard tunes, and he could play them in any key.
Wow.
And so I started off playing drums. I went to see Buddy Rich's band, when I was a little kid at a place in Quincy called the Beachcomber, which is just closed recently.
Yeah, I heard about that, yes.
They used to have all the jazz groups in there. I saw the Basie band there. I saw Maynard's band there when I was about five.
Really?
With the one with Lanny Morgan and all those guys from the early 60s that were on the band. I didn't know, and I just, you know,
yeah, well,
I was just overwhelmed by it. But
yeah,
he put the bug in my ear, and I saw Buddy Rich's band there in 1967, which was the band that recorded the Mercy Mercy record. Don Menzo and all those guys were in the band. And I was, it's a small club. I sat, you know, only a few feet away from the whole band, this little kid. I was just completely enamored with it.
Sure.
And so that kind of like put the seed in my head. So I wanted to play drums. And so I started playing drums when I was about six. And from between there and 12, that's all I did. I had a couple of good teachers. You know, I used to see every band. All these road bands came through Boston all the time. They worked for the Willard Alexander Agency, which is the same agency I worked for when I was in those bands. They were the big band booking agency in New York.
Wow.
660 Madison Avenue. I know the address because that's where all my mail used to go. And that was where anything got sent to you, you know,
sure,
in care of such and such a band. 660 Madison Avenue,
more importantly,
10021.
More importantly, that's where the checks came from on the return address.
No, the checks?
No.
You got paid on the road.
Oh, okay.
You got paid in all cash, right, actually.
Well, those are the good old days.
Well, yeah, you needed the cash. And I mean, there wasn't a whole lot of money to go around. I mean, you paid your expenses out of your salary, and it wasn't a whole lot of money. But the trade-off was you got to play with people that, you know, were really legendary. It was really your higher education.
Yeah.
You know, you go to a school like Berklee or any music school, and you know, even if you graduate, you know, you've only got the beginning tools. That doesn't mean that you're set to go out there. The real learning starts when you get out of music school. You just kind of learn the nuts and the bolts, and then when you in that day, when you had gigs like this come along, that's how you learned how to use them.
Wow.
And so anyway, I, you know, played drums for 6 years, and then I wanted to play saxophone, mostly because I had seen Don Menza play that ridiculous cadenza on Channel 1 Suite.
Okay.
And I just was enamored by it. I was more, you know, every time I saw the big bands, I was more interested in the saxophone players than anything else.
Really?
You know? And my father got me a tenor and a clarinet when I was 12.
Wow.
So I started on both.
What was the one thing that was the biggest difference between going from drums to going to a reed instrument? I mean, besides the amount of cases you had to lug around.
Well, yeah, the advantage was that I had learned to be really good at reading rhythms.
Okay.
You know, because the drum teachers I had me reading as well as playing. So my sight reading was really good in terms of all of the note values and the rhythms, and I just had to learn the notes. And I knew that pretty well just from what little piano my father would show me. I knew where the pitches were and all the Every Good Boy Deserves Fudge and all of the,
yes,
you know, all
F-A-C-E.
Of the things. F-A-C-E,
yeah,
exactly,
yes,
you know, in both clefs. And so when I started playing, I immediately had a really great teacher who played both of those instruments. So every other week was either a clarinet lesson or a saxophone lesson.
Wow.
So I learned how to be a pretty good clarinet player right from the beginning. And shortly after that, I got a flute, too.
Okay.
Because in that process, my folks used to take me to see a lot of music. And in the summertime, we'd go to Cohasset to the music circus.
Okay, yeah, yeah.
In those days, they do book shows and a ton of star attractions. And I always like looking down in the pit and you see the woodwind players with a flute and a piccolo and a soprano and a, you know, a whole bunch of horns in each chair.
Yeah.
Which kind of is like what I do now. In fact, it is what I do now. But, you know, I was really interested in that. And then I go to flute and I found a teacher who also was a multi-woodwind player named Carl Longmire. He was a solo clarinetist with the Marine Band in the 60s.
Wow.
You know, they played the White House for presidents. Sure. All the big stuff. You know, that's what profile. He did. And he'd gotten his 20 in and he retired. He was teaching at a music school, at a music store in Quincy, the Charles Bean Music, which is where I got my first horn. And there was a bunch of little studios downstairs. So I had really good teachers, and my father always had me learning tunes, like standard tunes. I'd either learn them by ear, or he had fake books, but they were always in concert keys, so I had to learn how to spontaneously transpose a B for a B-flat instrument, which is reading it up a step.
Yeah, that's...
For tenor sax.
Yeah.
You just see it, and you read it up a step. I got to the point where I was a little better at that than actually reading things in the key they were in, you know, which was kind of a funny thing. But it's a skill that has been invaluable throughout my life.
So let's talk about, as you've progressed, you've played in Europe, you've played in Asia. Have you played in Africa?
No.
Okay. No. South America?
A little bit, yeah.
Okay. Brazil. North America?
Yeah.
Yeah, obviously, here.
All 50 states.
Really?
Yeah. At one time or another, all 50 states from different tours.
So some of the bands you've played with, some of the
first road gig I did, I was in Berklee for like 5 semesters, basically 2 years. I did a summer semester and did 5 in a row. And I had a chance to go on the road. And that's what that's kind of what you did at Berklee. You didn't necessarily go there to graduate unless you were looking to get an education degree.
Okay.
You know, if you were a performance major, you were studying with all of, you know, Joe Viola, Bill Pierce, George Garzon was a huge influence. And it was just an amazing, amazing guy that I learned so much from. And, you know, I was ready to get out and make use of some of this. And I got called to do the Tommy Dorsey Band with Buddy Morrow. Which was what they call a ghost band.
Sure.
There was that and the Miller Band, and later on the Artie Shaw Band started. Although Artie was still living, he didn't play, and Dick Johnson led the band.
Okay.
So I did that gamut for quite a while, and then after a couple of years I came home. I just had enough of the road for a while, and just started working a lot around here locally. You know, I got, you know, different kinds of gigs. I could always play tune gigs because I knew the tunes.
Sure.
And so I did a lot of that, and then... In 83, Dick Johnson was chosen to start to lead the Artie Shaw Band.
Okay.
And I was asked to play lead alto on it. And we did a series of rehearsals for about 2 months at the Back Bay Hilton in Boston. And Artie was there with his library that he had donated to Boston University. So we were playing basically the parts that he had in the original book.
Wow.
We had all the original parts.
That's quite historic.
And I learned a lot from Artie about being a lead alto player.
Really?
Invaluable things he really knew about, because he was not only a clarinetist and a leader and a, you know, kind of an icon, but for years he was a studio player. He was a lead alto player. In fact, he told me that you know, at some point, I forget who it was, determined that two of the greatest jazz tunes ever recorded was Begin the Begin and Can't Get Started. And Can't Get Started was Bunny Berrigan's, but Artie was the lead alto player in the session, so he was on both of them. So I learned quite a bit from that, and I did all the beginning concerts. We did a short tour, and we did all the big Today Show and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
And the Glen Island Casino had just been renovated and reopened, so we did a big opening there, because Artie used to play there a lot. And so I did that for a short time, and then not long after that, I got called to go with Buddy Rich. And
the boss.
Took the job, and Artie was kind of funny. I didn't see him for a few months, but I happened to come back to Boston, and he said, I hate to see you go. He said, why are you going with Buddy? It's such a waste of music.
I was like, yeah,
I don't know.
Yeah, take that.
He was a very opinionated guy. He'd say some things that were kind of funny. But so what happened was, one time, Buddy and I were on the bus. We were leaving New York to go on tour. He grabbed me by the arm and goes, hey, kid, come here. I said, yeah, what's up? I was over at Willard's office today, and your former boss had some very nice things to say about you. And me and Paul Phillips also, the late, great Paul Phillips from Providence, I had gotten him on the band. And so him and I were both on Artie's band when it started, and then I got him on Buddy's band long after I joined the band. So he said, he had very nice things to say about you two guys. And apparently Artie told him, he said, He said, "Yeah, you took my two best guys." You know.
Well, that's a great. Put that in the resume right there.
It really kind of sealed the deal for me. In a way, I mean, he was tough on everybody, but he never really was unreasonably tough on me. He never gave me a free pass for anything.
Sure.
But he didn't just jump all over me for no reason, because some of the issues with people on the band were personal.
Okay.
And there were people that provoked that.
Yeah.
You know.
Sure.
That was really the reason for a lot of those recorded sessions when he was yelling at us. It was provoked by, there were people that liked to start that kind of fire.
Well, and that's, you know, that's really indicative of any time you play with a group of people.
Yeah.
The more personalities, the more chefs in the kitchen.
Oh, sure.
All the analogies are there. The more personalities you bring in, obviously, the more elements and.
Well, this band, you know, and these kind of, particularly Buddy's, and I think probably two of Woody Herman and Maynard's band also, you've got almost all completely all improvisers. So you have improvisers' minds, which is like having a lot of chefs in the kitchen.
Yeah, sure.
And, you know, it's never about who's right or wrong. I mean, everybody's right in their own way.
Sure.
In speaking artistically.
It's interpretation.
Know? Yeah. And then, of course, you mix that in with the fact that most of us were in our early to mid-20s and we were kids.
Yeah. A little bit of aggression. A little tension.
So there was,
testosterone
build
up.
There was some naive aspects to that, too, you know. But, you know, what I got out of it was, you know, the whole time in the first year I got on the band, we were playing with Frank Sinatra. You know, we had a series. Anytime he had a gig, Buddy's band was the band that backed him up. So
okay.
He would be on tour, and then intermittently we'd get on a plane and fly to some big, usually like some big, like hockey arena kind of place in the Midwest. And some of the ones in the Midwest are pretty state of the art.
Wow.
You know, they were newer, and they were actually, you know, not always acoustically the best place to play. But, you know, it was quite an experience to get to do that. And we played with a lot of other star attractions, too. A real name drop is, you know, Mel Torme, Anita O'Day. Back my brain to think of it, but you know, we were paired up with a lot of singers.
Wow.
And the only times we ever did any real sit down work, because most of the time Buddy's band was one nighters.
Yeah.
We were on the bus 45 weeks a year, playing high schools and colleges and sometimes clubs, but that was mostly in the major cities. If you're in New York or LA, you play one of the more prominent places. But the majority of the work was, this was what we did, it was the bread and butter of the tour. We paid for the bus and put us on the road.
There you go.
And that whole kind of thing. And then, you know, intermittently we would stay at a Fairmont hotel in one of the cities for like a week or sometimes 2 weeks, paired up with an act.
Wow.
And that was like nice because we weren't on the bus and there was no traveling. We'd get a room at the place. And it was,
you could relax. You could be normal
for a little bit. Relax a little bit, yeah. Because the rest of the time it was just constantly on tour.
Yeah. You've over the years and over time you've evolved, and you are one of the original founding members of the John Allmark Jazz Orchestra, which performs based out of Providence, Rhode Island.
Yeah.
But it's a New England based band. It really is.
Yeah, there's a lot of Boston guys. For a while, it was a time when guys from Connecticut and even New York City would come up to play.
Right. And I don't want to be insulting with this, but you guys wouldn't, and I remember this because I worked with you guys for a little bit, you know.
You were a setup guy.
Lugging the boxes around. I got all big and strong.
Yeah, you did all the stuff we didn't want to do anymore.
There we go. But I specifically remember, and I forget who it was, but I remember being told one night, it's like, you know, this kind of gig on a Monday night, it's not about the paycheck. It's about the fact that we can play with each other, which we don't get the opportunity to do. And I've recently did a little bit of video work with you guys, and when you watch the video and when you watch you guys perform, there is such an awe and respect when one of the horn players takes a lead or a solo. It's that admiration, and you almost get that little nod.
Yeah.
You know, when you do something, it's like, wow, that was really good. It's that little nod.
Well,
and
it's a pretty amazing collection of talent. You know, it really is.
It's an insane collection of talent.
It's the best
talent
of everybody who's around.
Yes.
And, you know, there's really, it's more than a musical connection. I mean, it really is a fraternal kind of connection, too, because, you know, we're all colleagues. And yes, I think to some degree we probably compete for the same work in some instances, but I don't think anybody has ever had the gladiator syndrome. I mean, we've had players like that have gone, but I think, you know, the core of people who were there, it's not about winning. It's not about, you know, it's not about like who wins and who loses as much as, you know, it's really a collaboration of mutual respect. Yeah,
it's
because we really enjoy. I really enjoy sitting down in the sax section every time I'm there, and sitting next to Bill Vince, who's amazing, and Tucker Antel, who's out of this world.
Sure.
You know, and we all see it that way. And I've had the good fortune to find some younger players. I handle the personnel for the saxophones.
Yeah.
So I make the calls, and I pretty much decide who's there. And I've been able to reach out and find some younger players.
Yeah.
You know, because it's a natural evolution of things for people to move on. Some
sure.
Leave town. Or sometimes people just, you know, they either can't.
Well, sometimes, like yourself,
can't
make it happen. You get committed to a show, whether it be in New York or Providence or Boston or wherever.
Yeah. Anytime you're in the pit, you're doing 8 shows a week. And so I usually just have to have a night off.
Yeah, sure.
You know, Mondays are the nights that the theater's
sure.
off. So I don't usually. There have been instances when I've done it because if I don't get down there, they'd be short somebody. And just there is a limit to where we're going to make the calls, because you can't get people in there that don't have the experience to handle a job.
It
hinders everybody's job.
It's a very, very technically
challenging. You have a responsibility.
Sure.
You have a responsibility to think carefully about who is going to be there to do a good job and be comfortable with it. Because, you know, the thing is, you don't want to bring somebody in who's not the kind of player the band needs.
Right.
It's unfair to them because it'll be stressful, it'll be difficult. No one's going to, you know, no one's going to make it, go out of their way to make it difficult. It's not that kind of collection.
Correct,
but
it's
tough. So you really have to be considerate over who's really, you know, whose capabilities best fit this situation.
It's a very intentional decision that you
right.
make.
Because we're doing this solely for the music.
You exactly.
know, this is a very well-oiled machine, and the only other big band that's had this long of a history besides Bowie's is the Vanguard Band on Monday nights. They've been playing since 1965. Duke Belaire started doing his band in 1968, so there was a legacy throughout the time that the Bowie's existed until it closed last year. That they had the history with these two bands, and they're related because John's band was really an offspring of Duke Belaire's band.
Right.
Most of us who grew up here grew up playing in that band.
Yeah.
And we learned really the tools of the trade at a professional level, so that when we got called for a road gig, we were prepared.
Sure.
You know, we got thrown into a fire there. We had Hal Crook, Dick Johnson. My God, all the guys who were like the real cream of the crop in New England in my parents' generation.
Right.
Who at the time were about the age that I am now. And I'm 58.
Yeah.
And I was 20 something. You know, so
it's
now, and now fast forward to 2016, I'm 58 years old and I'm bringing in people who are now younger than my kids, who are almost 30. I'm bringing in kids in their early 20s. And the band is serving a really good purpose, which I think is even more important now because you don't have touring bands that stay out there to get what I got at that age.
That's
they just don't
true.
Exist anymore.
No, you're absolutely right. And, you know, the world has changed in that sense.
So it served a good purpose for that, too.
One of the things that you've mentioned a few times is bringing up that younger generation.
Yeah.
And the next time you guys are playing over at the Met, which is right on the Providence-Pawtucket line, if you can make it out, ladies and gentlemen, it's a phenomenal show.
It's January 9th. Yeah.
It's outstanding, 8:30. You just come and be amazed. There is a large section of young people that come. And when I say young people, I'm talking
anywhere from high school age.
14 years old right up to 25 years old, you know, college and high school students that are just enamored with the performability and they're really into it.
Yeah.
But this is also a great night. It's not a rough crowd. There's seats, there's tables and chairs there.
Yeah.
You can relax, have a beverage. And it's such a great step back into how things used to be.
Yeah.
They've got a great setup as far as sound and lighting over there at the Met.
It's extraordinary. You know, it reminds me of a place I used to play in New York with Buddy Rich called The Bottom Line, which was down in the Village.
Okay.
Similar setup, similar kind of place, and the stage was up high, and the sound was actually very good.
Yeah.
The first time I walked in there, that's what came to my mind. I said, oh, my God, this is like The Bottom Line. It's awesome.
It's so great.
Because Bovey's was, you know, it's a little tiny dive club. It was like playing in a shoebox. It had a low acoustically. There were issues. I was never really terribly comfortable there because the volume was a little high. You couldn't get a lot of balance out of it in a place like that. It's just the
John had to work the board himself.
And we didn't have monitors. We basically
had
the house sound behind us. It was a different thing. This place, you know, guy Frank, and I can't remember his last name, but the sound guy was absolutely wonderful. He's a real artist. He's like a musician. He painstakingly makes sure that the balance of the monitors and the wedges are right and in the house, and you really don't play hard.
Yeah.
That's really a
big difference.
Very cool, especially for a band that size.
Yeah. Some of the other musicians you have in there, obviously Vinnie Pagano from Providence.
Right.
John Allmark himself, I mean, obviously he's
Artie Montanaro.
Artie Montanaro.
Right.
Who is it Cranston East?
Cranston East, yeah.
Cranston East, he heads up the music department.
Great
there.
Musician and a absolutely tremendous.
And then your horn players, the trumpet players, which I know there's a lot of cycle through, but I mean you've got guys that have gone on and play with some really, you know, fusion funk groups like Lettuce.
Yeah.
And I mean, yeah, it's just
that'd be Eric. Yeah.
But these are guys that come from Rhode Island, come from New England, and you know, Massachusetts. Well, I mean,
well,
this area.
John's playing, which you know, obviously is extraordinary. Has been a really amazing mentor. You know, he really has kind of set the standard, set the bar to rise up to. And,
sure.
You know, he does do that. I mean, he can be quite cynical sometimes, but you know something, he always sets the example. He can put his money where his mouth is.
Yeah.
You know, he has amazing facility on the instrument. Most trumpet players have to practice 10 hours a day to do what he can do. He can come in and having literally not played for a week, like this time of year when it's a holiday week.
Yeah.
And most of us don't touch the horn. You got other stuff going on. He comes in and he sounds amazing. Brass players, in most cases, don't do that without chipping notes and having their chops get tired and all that kind of thing. He's superhuman that way.
Sure, sure.
And he sets a really high standard. And the trumpet section, brass, I mean, the whole band really, but I think just for trumpet players, you know, he's setting an example. If I can do this, you better be able to do it too.
Absolutely.
And they do. You know, we have the main lead trumpet player on the band is Ross Hill, who's absolutely phenomenal.
Yep.
I mean, he's world class. He can sit next to anybody, anywhere.
I scared him one time. He was playing for the Rhode Island Philharmonic, and I was helping out a camera crew one time, and because I was the smallest guy, they had me on the stage with a small camera, you know, getting, you know, artists and stuff.
Sure.
And I literally showed up like right in his feet, like, "Hey," he's like, "What are you doing?" Just good time. Sorry, Ross. I strictly for the gig, you know, needed the shot.
He's really tremendous. Yeah. We have a variety of guys who are also amazing. So, well, we have also Yari Munoz, from Cuba. He's another amazing lead trumpet player who will step in. He plays second a lot of the time. He steps in and covers Ross when he's not there and really does a tremendous job. And Doug Olson, who's a great, great, great soloist, and he teaches in Medfield. I meant to tell you, you know, you probably remember one of the things we used to do at Bovies, which we're trying to get going at the Met, is we have high school groups come in and play a set before us.
Yes, I remember you did that with
Classical High School, and Doug brought his group in from Medfield one time, too. And I think that's also a good thing. They get into play in the environment that we play in.
Oh, it's so great.
And then get off the bandstand, and then we go in and light the place up.
That's so great. And, you know, they bring in their families, and it really bodes well for the art, for the craft that you guys have really worked so hard to perfect.
Yeah.
For those who may not have recognized a lot of the names that you've said, you've played with a lot of shows and a lot of artists.
Star attractions.
That may be more recognizable to the common casual
Natalie
listener.
Cole. We played with Natalie Cole a lot.
Yeah.
Mel Torme, Barry Manilow.
Billy Joel.
Tony Bennett quite a bit.
Okay.
He used to use the big band. You know, those things always come around. There's less and less of it, you know, over the years. When I was younger, the summer venues used to always have a lot of star attractions that hired local players. You know, that's just the way the books were set up. I mean, now you're not seeing so much of that anymore. It's kind of being done a little bit differently now.
But you've also played with a number of Broadway shows, and
I started getting into that. I lived in New York in the 90s, and, you know, what you do is you sub on Broadway. You know, nobody really ever has their own show until you're there for quite some time. But it's actually better being a sub, you know. Cover this, and I also toured with some national companies with shows too. I did that for quite a few years, and that was.
What's some of your favorite shows that you've played with?
Well, you know, I did Cats, I did Avenue Q, I toured. Fosse, 42nd Street, and these are tours that go out and stay out for a while. Like you go to a city and stay for 2 or 3 weeks.
Right.
So it's not like doing the one-nighters with the bands. You know, sure. It's a little less painful. In back in the day, it used to be really good money, and the reason you do it is if you're going to give up your life at home, you want to at least get out there and save a chunk of change, which I did. And then the last time I did it was about 15 years ago when I went with Fosse and got me on my feet after a divorce.
Wow.
You know, but, you know,
life happens.
And you're playing with great musicians. It was probably one of the last times that a rather sizable ensemble was self-contained traveling.
Yeah.
Except for we'd have layoffs in cities like Boston that have local hiring rules. But, you know, we'd stay out for quite a while. You know, and then I did that. And then when I came back to Boston, I pretty much fell into doing most of what comes to Boston. You know, most of the theater stuff that came to Boston that was hiring. And as time went on, the groups have been getting smaller and smaller. And it's usually just either two or three woodwind chairs with a lot of doubles.
Right.
And they downsize the scores. So, I mean, you make good money doing that, but what happens in that process is that you play a lot more. You don't come up for air because you're covering other chairs that aren't there. So you're always playing.
Which is...
It's tiring.
Yeah, it can wear you out.
But it also gives you iron chops, and, you know, you get something good out of that, too.
Anybody who knows me knows I've always been a big fan of, obviously, live music.
Sure.
And I will wait until the very end, wait until the crowd leaves.
Yeah.
To, if I have to, make my way down to the front and give a nod or a thank you or just, hey, you guys sounded great to the pit, because...
It means a lot to, you know, we always have people that do that, and I'll tell you, especially now where, you know, live music is struggling to exist over recorded.
Sure.
You know, for a variety of reasons, mostly greed, but it's always good to have people do that.
Yeah.
Sometimes one of the funniest things that happens is, you know, we've always had the standing joke where somebody will come down and say, are you guys local or professional? But they mean well in the process anyway. You know, it is nice that they recognize that, especially when they bring kids down to see the instruments. And
see
that music doesn't come just from an iPod. It actually has to, you know, the sound you're hearing comes from instruments and breathing. And, you know.
And it's one thing when you guys are actually down in a pit and you're a little, you know,
you are.
And in some theaters, you're actually in another room watching on little monitors.
Yeah, you are.
But, the circus, which I know you've subbed in.
Used to do the Ringling Brothers for years when it came to Boston. I mean, way back before I started even going on the road, I used to... Because it used to come to Boston and stay for like 10 weeks.
Right.
It would stay for a long time.
Yeah.
It was a local hire. And, you know, it would be a pool of people that would be subs. You know, that you'd have the orchestra that's hired and everybody would have their... Because nobody could outdo all of them, especially if you had a teaching job. And even in the 80s, after I got back from Buddy Rich's band, I was on the faculty at Berklee for about 5 years.
Wow.
I was actually hired to come into Berklee, and I finished my degree while I was on the faculty.
Really?
Which you couldn't do it for free. I did it for free in the day.
Well,
that's what I was doing. And, you know, I'd play the Ringling Brothers, you know, do about 10 shows a week.
Wow.
You'd do 6 of them on the weekend. 3 Saturday and 3 Sunday, which absolutely turned the brass
six
players
pack.
Into
absolutely.
Raw hamburger.
Yep.
The six packs. And, there used to be a lot of, you know, more long-term things that would come into town where you do sit-down jobs like that.
But when you have those kind of jobs, specifically Ringling Brothers, those musicians are out in the open. They're part of the arena.
Yeah, you're usually somewhere up you're visible.
You people still don't recognize that, oh my goodness, that wasn't a tape. That wasn't a cassette.
How did
those sound effects happen when, you know, when the people did that triple flip or whatever?
Yeah.
Today's
orchestra pit orchestras, it's really weird because you have very small bands. You also have keyboards that double everything you play.
Sure.
You have at least 2, sometimes 3 or 4 keyboards in the pit.
Wow.
One of the things that happens in Broadway is whatever size the orchestra is on Broadway, it's going to be probably a third smaller on the touring.
On
books.
The tour.
They reorchestrate the book for it to be smaller. Because a Broadway show in New York, a successful Broadway show in New York breaks even.
Yeah.
The cash cows are the touring companies. That's where they make their money. They don't make it in New York.
Wow.
So if a show is really big and successful, they're just staying out of the red. That's all they're doing.
That's impressive.
And if it's really successful, they put one on tour and sometimes 2 companies.
Okay. East Coast, West Coast.
Or sometimes what they do is one company will go to the big cities and do longer stays, and the other one goes to the smaller cities and does either 1 week or split weeks.
Okay.
And that'll run until it gets down to one-nighters, and then it phases out. It seems to be the norm for the last 10 years or so.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Interesting. As far as kids, you know, going, playing music in the schools, I mean, it's unfortunate, but it always seems to be the first thing that gets cut.
Yeah.
Is the music program.
Yeah.
Even if there's a music program, how valuable is having private lessons in addition to
the ensembles and the rehearsals
that's provided at
I think it's really one hand washes the other, because you know, if you don't know the nuts and the bolts of the instrument, you're not going to be able to get through even the easiest piece of music.
Sure.
If you want an orchestra or a band or combo or anything to sound good, you really have to have a fundamental knowledge.
Yeah.
It's like kids in sports. I mean, you know, they get in the gym and work out and get some muscle tone to be able. It doesn't mean they're going to play better. I always make this analogy with practicing, because you have the practice room practicing, which is the scales and the arpeggios and the nuts and the bolts. That's like working out in the gym. That just gives you the physical capability to play the horn.
Yeah.
And then there's the scrimmage, which is the rehearsals for band kids. And for sports, you get out there and you get your ass kicked all over the place to be a football player.
Yeah.
Or you know, you get beamed by a couple of pitches to learn how to swing and hit the ball right. You know, that's where you get good at that. And that's
right.
What the rehearsals do. And it's really kind of the same thing with instrumental music. You need somebody to teach you to play an instrument, not only so that you'll get the right things, also so that you don't develop the wrong things, bad habits.
Yeah.
They can be really counterproductive. And sometimes when you get a kid who's not had the right instruction for more than a couple of years, the most difficult thing is undoing the bad habits before they start
break
doing things
down
right.
Before, yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
No, that's
so yeah, it's really important. And I think also just culturally it's important, because you know, like I grew up in Milton where I live now, and thanks to the internet and Facebook, I've reconnected with a lot of people I grew up with. And I think myself and Dave Burdett, who's another musician in Boston, great trumpet player, him and I are really the only two out of that class that became professional players. But we were in a school band that was exceptionally good.
Right.
We had a very good music department. We had a great band director named Dan Evans, who's a wonderful guy. He just retired recently. And, you know, we were very fortunate to have mentors there. There was another guy who taught language there named Leon Merrigan, who was a very well-known world-class trumpet player who lived in New York for a number of years. But he was also brilliant at language. He spoke five languages. Amazing lead trumpet player, amazing jazz player. We had this guy right in the school who used to come down and teach us stuff that we probably would never have learned if he wasn't there.
It's outstanding.
So we had all these extraordinary opportunities. I was in high school from 70. I graduated in 77, so it was the mid-70s.
Yep.
But, you know, it's funny.
You graduated when you were 5 years old, which was very
impressive.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, I was one of those prodigy kids. You know? But, you know, it's funny. I talk with people who were in the school band. You know, obviously their careers went in other directions, and they don't play anymore, but they also all... They all say the same thing, that you know, that their experience with music was really crucial to their life having some meaning. And you know, that they still, you know, a lot of them still go out, like if they live around New York area, they go to the clubs and hear bands, and they love the music. You know, it's important, you know, even if you just play a little bit. I think just the cultural side of it, you know, that's what's going to be missing in this next generation. I mean, if it gets completely taken away, I think the value goes way beyond just the preparation for people aspiring to be professional players. I think it's something everybody needs.
Right.
You know, you need that, like you need every other part of education. You need to know history. You need to know the basics of math. You know, it's amazing how, actually, when you become a homeowner, you know, the little things you learn in math and all these little things you think you're never going to use, and then you find yourself doing it to fix a door.
Sure, absolutely.
Or, you know, how to add things up. Or, you know, it's like all these silly little things you remember where you learned them.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, I learned this in fourth grade
from
Miss Blumenthal. You know, like you'd even remember their names. You know, it comes back 50 years later.
Yeah,
well,
that's good.
I think also, you know, the exposure to music is a lot of time the same things. You see, we all used to, as a group, go see these bands. You know, we'd go see Maynard's band. Brockton High School, which isn't too far from here, was one of the venues that all the Willard Alexander bands would play. We saw Buddy Rich, Woody Herman, Maynard Ferguson, Stan Kenton. Lynn Viviano, who was a trumpet player that played with Buddy, started his own band. He was out for a couple of years, and it had most of the same players from Buddy's band on it. So every year we would see, or I would see anyway, probably a dozen, ten or a dozen live concerts every year with these bands. Plus, also, these bands were putting out a record every year.
Yeah.
Every year you had another record to look forward to.
That's great.
And learn all the stuff. And then at this point also, the bands, especially Woody Herman's band, they were publishing the charts. So our high school jazz band was playing the charts that were on the record.
Wow.
You know, so it was fantastic. You know, we in some cases they were a little beyond over our head.
Yeah.
But we were still getting a crack at it because we'd sit and listen to the record, learn how to play it.
Yeah.
And then read it, and then you'd get to have the visual go with it, and then you know it was a great thing.
And that all enhances your skill, your sight reading ability, your ability to comprehend what's going on. It's that's.
When I get on Buddy's band, we occasionally would do some clinics at schools. You know, we'd get in at noon and we'd play there that night, but you know they would have a couple of our charts.
Wow.
And Buddy would play one of them, like Mellotone, one of the easier ones, like Mellotone or Wind Machine or something. Sure. And so usually one of us would do kind of what I do over at Rhode Island College for Joe Foley. You know, I'd get the saxophone section and rehearse them like I rehearsed my own section. We'd tear everything apart and nitpick every note, talk about dynamics and how to listen to each other and how to play in tune together. You know, all the nuts and bolts of musicianship. And then we'd get them out there, and it was a nice feeling to do that. Maynard Ferguson did that a lot.
Wow.
You know, he, the last bunch of years of his band being on tour consisted of doing that most of the time.
Yeah.
And they play, you know, he had his own hit with Rocky theme, which was a hit right through the rest of his career.
Yeah.
The bands would learn it, and then Maynard would play his famous high note trumpet part with it. I remember I saw it at Brockton High School one time because some friends of mine were in the band. This was like 89 or 90. And you could just see how thrilled the kids were with that. You know?
Sure.
It's really a life-changing experience to do that.
Absolutely. Well, let's talk about changing lives here. If you haven't had a chance, if you've never gone and seen them, folks, please get out Monday, January 9th. Go see these guys. Follow them on Facebook and find out when they're playing next.
We have a Twitter page that I started.
Twitter, too. Yeah. They're tweeting, ladies and gentlemen.
We're tweeting it.
Absolutely.
And,
but it helps to keep the music alive. Bring your kids. Bring somebody who may be interested in this because that's what keeps the music alive and that's what keeps this whole generation going. I mean, it's so vital, it's so critical, and it really gives a great appreciation. This is a world-class band playing in Rhode Island.
Yeah.
Musicians coming from all over New England to do this. So this has been great. This has been a great ride, Bob.
My pleasure. I
greatly appreciate
it. Thank you so much.
And by the way, he's going to be a grandpa pretty soon.
Yeah.
I know it's hard to believe, but this young's, you know.
I'm actually not going to be on the January gig.
I'm
leaving for Florida on the 8th.
Oh, no.
But I will be managing the players that are there. It'll
Very good.
Be great players.
He's but, become a snowbird, ladies and gentlemen.
Somewhat. I'm actually working down there.
Oh, good.
I'm doing a show for a month down there, and I've got some gigs with Joe Delaney, who's a great pianist from up here, who lives down in Florida, and we play together a lot. And my daughter Kate's having her first grandchild. You know, it's a girl. She's due the first week of February.
So okay, so get back quick. And
we'll be doing that, and I will be back after the Pops tour, probably early April. I'll be back with the band again.
Awesome. Well, keep in touch. And ladies and gentlemen, I mean, I'm sitting here literally with music legendary. I mean, this is music royalty right here. At some point.
Kind.
I try. So, checks in the mail. So, Bob, thanks again.
Thank you, Ben.
Happy 2017. Go see some live music.
Yeah, come see the band, folks. You won't be sorry.